loss, part of a legacy for the Katrina generation.
It's almost like a nightmare. You know, you just want to wake up.
Overcoming the unknown.
You don't put it on, just hold it on your chin.
Turning pain into pride.
There have just been certain moments like that just feel like, wow.
A decade after they were robbed of their youth, a generation finds its voice.
For children, the world can be a scary place, one of unexpected and sudden changes.
When Hurricane Katrina roared ashore, they bore an unequal share of the suffering. Many of them lost loved ones, their homes, pets, all that they knew.
Tonight, we'll introduce you to five young men and women, the Katrina generation.
Each of them found a way to survive and ultimately thrive. When everything seemed gone, they never lost hope.
In the days and weeks following Hurricane Katrina's landfall, people around the world watched in horror as images of the immense devastation were broadcast. Footage like this showed the dramatic rescue of people from attics and rooftops. One of the most haunting images of Hurricane Katrina was the rescue of a teenager from the attic of her Gentilly home. For years, people have questioned the teen's fate. Tonight, for the first time in a decade, Courtney Jackson shares her story. She sits down with our Travers Mackle to reflect on the years gone by and how her experience would eventually lead to greatness.
Scott, you remember the scene. The water, 8, 10, 12 feet high, swallowing up anything in its way. From the sky, a saturated landscape dotted by the rooftops of homes and often little else recognizable. The rescues in this part of Gentilly were daring, and one teenager pulled out of her home didn't let the rising waters that almost ended her life drown her dreams. A city submerged.
Unbelievable, one of the many rescues that are taking place here.
And tens of thousands of people stranded.
Which one? Right here? With the red and white on it?
Within hours of the levee break, much of Gentilly looked like this. This is Elysian Fields near Interstate 610. And 10 years ago, on August 29th, 2005, a boat was the only way to navigate the treacherous conditions.
You could just hear people whistling from every direction.
I was with the WDSU News photographer that day. We got on this boat with NOPD officers to document their work. And as the camera started rolling, we witnessed an unforgettable rescue. The officers spotted a call for help. Someone waving a stick with a towel tied to the end of it out of an attic vent on a flooded home.
What about this window right here?
The rescuers busted in the window and a figure emerged from the attic, a teenage girl who didn't know how to swim.
I'm holding on to this.
No, let go of that. Put your arms on that life preserve.
How deep is that water right there?
The cops tossed her a life vest.
You don't put it on, just hold it on your chin. Like this. Yeah, hold it like that.
And eventually got her to the boat.
What was going through your mind here?
I just thought I was gonna die. Because the water came in so fast, so I thought I was gonna die real quickly.
The officer who led the rescue, NOPD Sergeant Danny Scanlon, recounts that moment when all the rest of the chaos would have to wait. And all his focus.
Come on! There you go.
Was directed at one teenage girl.
I remember she was extremely scared. She got on there and she kind of dog paddled over and she got out the water and got into the boat.
Thank you.
All right.
She was like so many other teens. And within minutes, Courtney, her 85-year-old grandmother, her mother and uncle were on their way to safety. As we did with many of the people we met back then, we asked her for her name.
Say your name and spell it for me.
Courtney, C-O-U-R-T-N-E-Y.
What's your last name?
Jackson.
That was then, this is now. What do you think looking at it now 10 years later?
It looks different.
But the memories don't change.
Is it hard to talk about and think about sometimes?
Yeah, it is. It is. Because sometimes I just want to put it out of my mind and just not think about it. But I can't not think about it because I'm from here. I grew up here. This happened to me. It's a part of me, a part of who I am. So I can't just get rid of it or try to, like, suppress it.
And who she is now, that was forged by this storm. Courtney is all grown up now, and she learned one of the lessons of her life back in the summer of 2005. Never give up hope.
And that was not going to hinder my dreams. That was just a stepping stone. It's just a part of my story.
And what a story it is.
It was coming in really fast, like I said already. And then we were in this room here.
A story that didn't end in this house on the day Katrina toured through town. Her story is one of inspiration. Let's go back, way back. Courtney grew up in New Orleans East, graduated from Gentilly Terrace and then St. Mary's Academy before heading off to college.
The summer of 2005, I had just completed my first year at Xavier University.
That summer, New Orleans was threatened by many storms, Arlene, Dennis, and Cindy. None of them packed much of a punch.
We're going to be here throughout the duration of the storm. Thank you for joining us.
But as Katrina neared, Courtney thought things may be different.
We went to my grandmother's house. She lives in Gentilly. And after that, we were getting calls from my dad. And my dad was kind of telling me to, you guys, he think we should leave. He was definitely encouraging us to leave. But I was like, nah. And I had an opportunity to leave to go to Texas, but I didn't want to leave my mom. And my mom didn't want to leave her mom. So we stayed, and you know, the rest is kind of history, I guess.
The levees broke, the city flooded, and she was trapped.
So going outside was not an option?
No, it wasn't. Not at all. We was just kind of just waiting to process out and just kind of see how things was going to turn out.
Y'all were basically stuck here?
Yep, stuck.
So this is it. This is the spot where you were dangling and the cops were out that window.
Yeah. Yeah, so I came, I think it was like right around this area here. They had a hole and my legs were just dangling down. And the boat was like right there. And that's when I was, the guy threw me a life vest because I was scared. So you saw my legs first and then finally my arms were just holding on to the rods or whatever it was. And then finally, that's when I jumped down. They had a bunch of stuff, more stuff in this room at that time. And then that's when I just came up and he just kind of pulled me on, you know, into the boat.
You were scared in the video, and rightfully so.
Yeah, I mean, I was a teenager then, so I never experienced anything like this. I heard about all the other hurricanes with Betsy and
Camille,
like, you know, and I wasn't alive for those. So to see this, yeah, it's just fear. Like, so yeah, that was the face of everybody.
Face of fear at the time.
Right, exactly.
Courtney and her family ended up on the interstate and were later taken downtown by a Good Samaritan.
So after that, we went to the Superdome, and I was in the Superdome for a few days. That was a horrible experience.
With the dome in disarray, Courtney and her mother were sent to Pasadena, Texas.
You had nothing but the clothes on your back.
Nothing. Nothing at all. Pajama pants. And I didn't even have any shoes on, I don't think. Yeah. So basically, the clothes off my back.
And then there was insult added to injury.
People will call like refugees and stuff like that. And that's very insulting because New Orleans is not a third world country. So there's no reason or right for people who don't even know us or what we're about to call us refugees.
Courtney and her mother spent months in Texas dealing with insurance claims and flooded homes. They'd lost everything from clothes to cars. This is Courtney's Honda sitting in her grandmother's driveway in Gentilly after the water receded. It was a high school graduation present, now destroyed. But despite the overwhelming situation, the kind of blow that made it unlikely they would even return to the city, Courtney would resume her college education right where it began. In January of 2006, just months after the dramatic rescue, she jumped at the chance to come back when Xavier University reopened.
I knew there was a light at the end of the tunnel, so I just had to keep pushing through until I got there. So I couldn't give up. Give up for what?
Courtney wanted to prove to herself, her friends, and everyone else who saw this video that even though she seemed helpless, she wasn't hopeless.
What is a badge of honor? It's like, if I can make it through that, I can literally make it through anything.
And less than 3 years after she was stuck in a flooded home, evacuated to Texas, and left with nothing but the clothes on her back, Courtney graduated from Xavier. From there, she headed to Washington, D.C. to attend Howard University's School of Dentistry. where she used strength gained through life experiences to focus on her studies.
If I can get through Katrina, I got through dental school, I can get through pretty much anything. So yeah, dental school is a cakewalk compared to Katrina, so it helped.
That it did. She graduated from Howard's Dental School in 2013 with honors. Today, Courtney is known to her colleagues and to patients as Dr. Jackson. She lives in D.C. and has a practice in Maryland, a dream come true.
I couldn't let Katrina or anything else like deter me from my dreams because I'm very determined and motivated. And my mom even told me when I graduated dental school, she was like, I'm so proud of you. She said that she was just so proud of me that she knew that I would be successful. So, you know, to hear that from my mom is just so, it's amazing because you just never know if you're doing the right thing, and for someone to tell you that you're doing good, it's just a good, it's a good feeling, yeah.
Katrina couldn't drown any of your dreams.
No, it couldn't, nope. And any other dreams that I have, like, it can't, nope. Mm-mm.
Just glad to be alive.
A decade on, Courtney still receives plenty of questions about the storm.
A lot of other people always ask me about Katrina and what happened and was I there when the flood water. So I have to go into the whole spiel about being rescued and stuff like that. Sometimes I don't like to talk about it because I don't like to rehash those old memories, but it's a part of who I am and I can't escape it because this is what happened.
And as someone who went through hell and back, she knows all too well her story may inspire people who are down on their luck, having fallen on hard times.
My advice for others is just don't give up hope. I know at the time it seems like it's a dark, scary place. You don't know what's gonna go on or what's gonna happen in the next day, the next few months. Just keep your head up and just keep going.
Courtney Jackson is one of the 60,000 people plucked from rooftops and flooded homes. 60,000. Missions carried out by first responders whose efforts saved literally countless lives, young and old.
Everyone responds to tragedy differently. Some give up or give in, while others amaze us with their resilience. Christina Quintana was a senior at Ursuline when Hurricane Katrina struck. And as our Heath Allen explains, her story of tenacity has taken the theater world by storm.
This is Broadway, New York City. When the Great White Way is lit up, there truly is magic in the air. When Hurricane Katrina washed people to the proverbial four corners, young Christina Quintana landed here. And it's right here, on Broadway, that she wants to make her splash. She's just a little drink of water in the enormous sea of humanity that is New York City. But Christina Quintana knows a lot about swimming against the tide, taking whatever challenge life hurls her way, and not just surviving, but thriving. 10 years ago, a brand new senior at Ursuline Academy, elected student body president, the back to school dance, the Friday before Katrina.
It just all happened so fast, like it was like we were there and and we were out, and then we were, in this place in Houston, and then it was like suddenly I had to go and like move to St. Louis for 4 months and be there and like just live my life, and I'm very good at coping.
A decade later.
And there's actually a new number now in the beginning.
Christina makes her own share of waves in the theater and arts community of the Big Apple. They say the neon lights are bright on Broadway, and they are. Attracted by the magic, Christina works to bring her own Katrina story to the Broadway stage. She has found a kindred spirit in Brett Macias. He's crafting the tunes. She has penned the story, the script, and lyrics to Gumbo, a musical based on the storm that redirected so many lives, including her own.
It's basically the city sort of getting ready for the storm, for the oncoming storm. And like, I think that just, it came so naturally, because that just feeling of like where we all were when we were waiting and wondering and hoping and praying.
The waves are coming, the wind is coming, hear a bigger roaring from the sea.
Ooh-wee. Like mist in Louisiana Moss, Christina evokes a measure of both mood and reality, reaching deep and taking us back to moments now permanently woven into the fabrics of our collective memory.
Got a whole lot of canned food, got a whole lot of plywood.
You know when it feels right and when it doesn't feel right, and there have just been certain moments like that just feel like, wow.
Wow is right. Gumbo, a celebration of the raucous, rowdy resiliency of a city and its people, bending but never bowing to the whims and the will of Katrina. A story that resonates with everyone, especially those who take the stage to share it.
You lived it, and the music and the text are just, they speak volumes. I mean, we learned here, now God knows, the rhythms for that is insane. But it was so powerful and impactful.
I think there really was a moment before the resiliency, you know, to talk about the loss of hope.
In spite of all this tragedy, in spite of like their homes and, you know, being lost and all this, you know, difficulty, that it's still like where their heart was.
There's like a spirit that New Orleans has and that the people of New Orleans have. And that's something that both in the music and I think in the words, like, we just want to have that. We want to capture that.
She doesn't have to tell me how important the city is because I can see it in her eyes.
How many thousands of people come to New York every year with the dream of Broadway, their name in lights? That kind of lightning strikes but a few. The rest pay their dues every day. A published award-winning poet and short story author, her plays have been produced in New York, Atlanta, and New Orleans. She's also the founder of the Live Lunch series, unique midday theater in the New York City workplace. Christina shares life with partner Sarah and a diverse circle of friends, always creating, always writing. And she volunteers with the 52nd Street Project, a group of professional actors and writers who mentor kids in New York's Hell's Kitchen, sharing life's lessons, giving young people in a tough neighborhood a nudge towards success. Christina wrote Light Up the Park for the project, and the song, too.
Watch us do the fire.
There is still plenty of the kinds of things that come with poverty. And there are still a number of housing projects where most of the kids that we work with come from. And we're basically giving them opportunities that they more than likely would not have otherwise.
A lot of us sort of had those kind of situations, and they just like were so kind and so wonderful and just brought us in with such open arms. And so I think just because of that, I've always wanted to give back.
From Ursuline Academy at NOCA, the New Orleans Center for the Creative Arts, Hurricane Katrina launched Christina down a long and winding road that brought her here to the heart of the theater world. And believe it or not, her best friend, all the way back to the fifth grade, well, she landed here too. Different journey, but they're here.
Do you see yourself?
What did it look like?
I don't. I don't know where I am.
I can find you.
I think I'm right there.
Yeah, that's you.
I vowed that I wouldn't go to school for theater. I decided that I wasn't going to do it. I didn't want to be a broke artist. And so I'm not.
Gabrielle is not an attorney, but she has played one on TV. She's also been in commercials and in a national tour of the play Hairspray and much more. Gabe and Tina look back fondly on what they had before the storm and what they missed when their senior year in high school was lost to a feckless mass of wind and rain that made them grow up in a hurry.
Things happen, and this is just a test of life, I guess. How can you take it any way else? I mean, life doesn't stop just because a tragedy like Katrina happens.
When they fled Katrina, Gabrielle wound up in Alexandria, Louisiana. Some culture shock there, coming from New Orleans.
And yes, the boys got first day of squirrel season off, and the girls had to stay.
It's just not fair.
And so maybe I should have asked my daddy for a shotgun.
Christina would spend the first half of her senior year in St. Louis, staying with a friend and attending Ursuline, as it's called there. The memories, the emotion, never far away.
The day that we were supposed to have our ring ceremony, we went to like a dollar store and picked up these little like stupid rings and went to Shake Shack and and had our own little like celebration. And I think I still have it actually somewhere because it was, but it was, why am I getting emotional about it? Wow, I was expecting that. But yeah, like, because we just like had each other, you know?
Here's a song that will soothe ya.
Something. What flows from the heart and soul of Christina Quintana is real. No matter how you experienced Katrina, you know she did.
There's this really great Leo Tolstoy quote that I keep with me all the time where he says, if you want to be universal, sing your village. And when I think about this show, to me, it's like the opportunity to be able to sing the city, you know?
And
like,
when our city sings, they sing.
They sing well. You heard that.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 4, 2, 3, 4. While diminutive in size, Christina Quintana writes like New York, Broadway big. A street that runs, as one of New York's finest told me, from here all the way to forget about it. Broadway, it's the goal. But life journeys, hers and everyone else's, take many turns, deeply personal. You'll find her in venues like Dixon Place, a neighborhood gathering spot for musicians, poets, creative performers, a veritable meeting of the muses.
Proud former Lambda Literary Foundation Fellow in Fiction, please welcome Christina Quintana to the stage.
When people ask me why I rarely act anymore, I tell them, because once I realized who I was, I didn't have the desire to dress like someone else anymore.
If Katrina did nothing else, she set people on paths of self-discovery. For writers, a time to go deep into themselves, bare their souls. It's what artists do. Never far away from the stage, Christina lives her craft, fearless in what she writes and reveals.
I felt like someone else, like a rag doll with a buzz cut, moving aimlessly through the city. And I never wanted to feel like that again. Thank you all so much. Thank you.
True to herself and to her experience, Christina is determined to bring gumbo to the Broadway stage. For collaborator Brett Macias, the project is his biggest yet.
What I love about Christina is that she has a really like amazing gift for words and description. And she knows exactly what she wants, and she'll tell me what she wants. And I'll fight her on what she wants.
Yep.
But in the end, she'll get what she wants.
Well, if you can make it there, you can make it anywhere. And she's determined. For all the devastation that Katrina was, Christina's simple message rings true.
People came back, though, you know? People came back and they were like, we're doing this. Like, we're gonna stay here because we love this place that much. And like, at the end of the day, that's the show to me.
Heartfelt, from the Big Apple to the Big Easy. Now. Put your hands together for that.
Hurricane Katrina inspired 10 feature films, one Broadway play, and has been the subject of half a dozen storylines in major television series.
Out of the long, dark night.
What was going through your head? You know, your house, your neighborhood, what were you thinking about?
I have to get out of here.
These children of the storm found a brighter future.
I was separated from my mom, my grandparents.
They're inspirational stories of faith, hope, and survival.
I could have lost my life in Katrina.
When Chronicle Children of Katrina continues. This presentation of Chronicle Children of Katrina
is brought to you with limited commercial interruption by the Salvation Army of Greater New Orleans, the New Orleans Firefighters Association Local 632, and West Jefferson Medical Center.
When people think of the Salvation Army, they think of the Red Kettle. But today's Salvation Army is so much more, providing pathways of hope to those in need, helping people recover from natural disasters, feeding the hungry and housing the homeless, providing job skills training, and rebuilding lives. To learn more about our programs and services and how you can help, visit our website today. The Salvation Army, providing pathways of hope for 150 years.
Come hella high water? Well, 10 years ago, Hurricane Katrina delivered both. Your New Orleans firefighters worked around the clock to protect the city we love. Not a single firefighter abandoned their post. We fought countless fires in knee-deep water, and using our own boats, we rescued 18,000 people. Firefighters' commitment to you is strong. Stronger than Katrina, stronger than any fire, and stronger than any battle we find ourselves fighting.
Katrina taught us the importance of family. As the storm approached, our hospital banded together to do what it does best, take care of our community. Like so many, we thought we had dodged a bullet. After the storm, we lost power and water. When the levees broke, our staff lost loved ones and homes. But what they did not lose was their will to care for our patients. Their compassion during this extraordinary time was one of West Jefferson's finest hours. Today, we thank our staff and physicians, our family caring for your family.
As the water subsided, something else poured in. Stories of bravery, courage, and survival.
First responders put forth heroic efforts in the days that followed the landfall of Katrina, saving thousands of lives.
It was that heroism that inspired Lionel Davis to pursue a career in public service.
And as Randy Russo explains, he's now giving back to a city that was nearly lost.
This is where life changed for so many, along this stretch of the London Avenue Canal in Gentilly. It wasn't the first flood protection structure to fail that day 10 years ago, but it was one of the most meaningful failures. It contributed significantly to the flow of water from Lake Pontchartrain into the city of New Orleans and into the lives of families, of teenagers like Lionel Davis. For him, this break changed everything, including what the future would bring.
Everybody's not, you know, built to do this job. I mean, some of the things you see can take a toll on you.
Lionel Davis is home.
Some of the things you may have to do can take a toll on you.
Here at Hook and Ladder 33.
It can be scary at times. Sometimes it can be, you know, fun. But all in all, it's rewarding.
At home on the west bank of the city in Algiers, protecting others just like they helped protect him, his family, his world.
People who are in distress and just need your help or just need somebody there sometimes to just do certain things for them. And we go there with a smile on our face every time, no matter if it's 7 in the morning or if it's midnight and, you know, we're trying to rest from the day of work.
Lionel witnessed the ultimate demonstration of that commitment 10 years ago. The men and women who waded through the floodwaters of Katrina, plucking people from their homes and bringing them to safety. Those who stayed when everyone else left. Those who responded when everything appeared lost. It inspired him. It set his life on this course.
I'm from New York. I work in Manhattan. I've been here for almost 19 years. We're here to help you guys. Your guys are the bravest. You are New Orleans firefighters, believe me.
I applaud them. They had more courage than I had at the time. They were brave souls, because it was really bad. Just looking back on it now, it was really bad.
Fresh out of high school back then, Lionel never imagined he would witness such horror. A storm of that magnitude wreaking havoc on his home, his neighborhood, his emotions.
It's almost like a nightmare, you know, you just want to wake up.
In 2005, Lionel had just graduated from JFK High School in Lakeview and was preparing to enroll at Southeastern Louisiana University in Hammond.
Starting college and had just finished all the paperwork, just really got my first call and, you know, just really just living, getting ready to get in that second stage of life, you know, as a young adult and getting out into the world, and you know, then around the time school's supposed to start, you know, the storm hits, and that just derailed all plans and everything that I had planned on doing.
Lionel and his family rode out the storm in the St. Bernard housing project, just like they had done plenty of times before.
We were just planning to go by my aunt's house and then, you know, stay there for a day or two, come back home like we did many times before. That just didn't happen this time.
What happened once you were there?
The waters rose. We actually thought it was just a normal flood and the waters would go down.
Right.
But that second day when we come outside and we don't see any of our vehicles and people from the floors under us started to come upstairs looking for refuge, it was, you know, that's when we realized it was serious.
What was going through your head? You know, your house, your, you know, neighborhood, what were you thinking about?
I have to get out of here. I have a cousin, actually. Her husband was one of the guys who found a boat, a flatboat, and got us to the interstate. And then when we got to the interstate, we were met by, that was military and firemen, actually. And we waited there for maybe an hour, and then we were got into a helicopter and flew the helicopter to another part of the interstate where we took buses. I think me and my dad stayed out there an extra day because we let the women go first, and my sister, because she has lupus, and I have a cousin and her son at the time. He had cerebral palsy, so all of them went first, and we just stayed back and waited for the next wave of buses to arrive. And they got on buses, and me and him stayed just to make sure that they all got on, and then we walked to find a rental car in Metairie, but we got turned around by Harry Lee at the time. Had to walk all the way back and wait in the line to get on buses, so it wasn't a pleasant experience.
For 2 days, Lionel and his father waited in the heat along the side of the interstate, taking turns sleeping. Only 10 weeks earlier, he had crossed the stage, a high school graduate, celebrating one of the greatest days of his life. Now, some of the worst.
We actually sat down on the, where the guardrails are, we sat down on the curb, and I dozed off. I was supposed to be holding watch so he can take a nap. I dozed off. For the most part, people were trying to come together, but after a while, frustration started to set in. People started getting irritated. You had a massive group of people who just lost everything.
We're trying hard. It's been hard out here. We're just taking one day at a time.
I can almost understand their frustration, and then they feel that they're not getting the proper help in a time frame they feel is justified. Everybody was, for the most part, frustrated. It was hot. It smelled.
When the two finally made it to the Houston Astrodome, his father rented a car and they began their second trek, this time to Baton Rouge to meet up with their family and start the long process of rebuilding homes and lives. When Lionel finally returned to the Crescent City, he realized his childhood had washed away.
As you can see, most of the other houses are gone now because it just was too bad for them to rebuild.
So when you finally got a chance to see your house for the first time, what did it look like?
It looked bad. The house was a mess. The inside, everything was thrown all around. There were shingles missing off the roof. The attic actually came down. It was really just bad. We had nothing to salvage, no pictures, no clothing, you know, just nothing. Everything was gone.
And just as so much of his hometown was gone, so too any notion of a gradual transition from teenager to man.
I had no choice because I have a sister that actually has lupus, so my parents were more taking care of her at that time. So now I have to go out and almost fend on for myself. And then by me going away to Southeastern, I'm in Hammond and, you know, they're in Baton Rouge. So at this point, I gotta become a man, even if I feel that I was robbed of a year or so of, you know, still being their kid.
He gave college a try for a couple of years, but ultimately it was the firefighters and the echoes of their heroism during the storm that led him down a different path.
Every kid's dream for the most part is to be a fireman at some point. It just got, you know, revamped when I saw those guys in action, you know, during that time. Every third day I go to work, I feel that, you know, I'm giving back, or I'm doing something to help someone like they helped me and helped so many people at that time.
For 4 years now, Lionel has dedicated his time, his sweat, and blood to the NOFD, and it's where he plans to stay for the long haul.
Yeah, I'm in it. I'm in it until I retire or until they kick me out.
Former New Orleans Fire Chief Charles Parent, who steered the men and women of the department during Katrina, believes Lionel and this new generation of firefighters will set the bar high when it comes to service in this city.
Everybody thinks of a fire department, you know, big, strong, muscular man that don't cry. Well, I've seen the other side of firemen. You know, they'll shed tears, but their biggest muscle is their heart, and they really believe in the community and they believe in helping out. And these guys, I feel very confident that they're gonna take the fire service and this fire department to heights that I never imagined.
For Lionel, that means striving to be the best he can be and to set an example for the children of the Crescent City, just like those before him did.
I know I used to look up to these guys, they were heroes to me at the time. And if something happens, I would have to be, you know, probably called into action to become a hero. So yeah, I'd say that for the most part, yeah.
Hurricane Katrina left her mark on Lionel's neighborhood, his home, and his life. But he says he's better for it, and he thinks his community is stronger for it. Though the physical things were wiped away, Lionel says he was able to cling to his faith and family. And that's made him into the man and father he is today.
Now it's almost a blessing, you know. So many things came from it. You know, I got into the career that I love and like to be in. I could be doing something that I may not like. Could be owing so much in student loans. But because that happened and then other things, you know, I'm here happy. I'm extremely grateful. There's no word that can describe it. At how grateful I am for the life that I have now. It's a beautiful thing.
Not a single member of the New Orleans Fire Department deserted his or her post during the disaster of Hurricane Katrina.
It can take time, months, years, but the most resilient among us can turn tragedy into triumph. Deshaun Dabney believes it. He was just a boy 10 years ago, but as Gina Swanson explains, sometimes an uncertain path leads to a very bright future.
Of all the things Hurricane Katrina claimed a decade ago, a positive attitude wasn't one of them. For Deshaun Dabney, he too lost everything, his family divided. But out of the hardship, a lesson on faith and the power of the human spirit. Yes, Deshaun Dabney experienced the wrath of Hurricane Katrina.
I could have lost my life in Katrina.
Yes, his family lost everything to the storm.
We can never erase Katrina.
Yes, he comes from humble beginnings.
We had no means of evacuating.
But he'll be the first to tell you, if you're looking for a sob story, you won't find one here.
It's so easy to fall out and just lay back and wallow in your own sadness and sorrow.
For Deshaun, finding the silver lining is more than a philosophy. It's a survival skill, a way of life. A child of the storm who's learned some grown-up lessons in its aftermath. While the places familiar to him were left in ruins, his spirit was unscathed.
I can't allow myself to be down there. It's not a good place to be.
It's a determination that's landed him in the company of director Spike Lee and an internship with Sony Entertainment, and even gained notice from the White House. While we asked him to look back on the past 10 years, his sights are firmly fixed on the road ahead. With his bright personality and wide smile, if something is troubling Deshaun Dabney, you'll never know it.
I never want to go out and just appear to be a victim or appear to be like I'm just so, you know, worn down and battered by the hardships of life.
He had just turned 14 when Katrina roared. When the waters rose, like other kids his age, he figured,
okay, school's gonna be out for a few days. We'll return on Monday. Not a big deal. To me, it was just a fun event. I really didn't understand what was about to happen.
His family, like so many in the neighborhood, prepared to ride out the storm at home.
We didn't have a car, we didn't have, you know, like I come from very humble beginnings. So my entire life, the majority of my life, I don't ever recall having a car. We used to just walk everywhere. You know, so in fact, we actually knew that we wouldn't be evacuating, so we just kind of stacked up on groceries and stuff like that.
He and his grandmother prepared to hunker down at the family shotgun double on Orleans Avenue.
My grandma and I slept together on her side, and my mom and my brother were on the other side. My grandmother owns the entire house, so it's a double side. And like I mentioned, my grandma and I were extremely close, so she definitely also took in the festivities the night before, had a couple drinks, and, you know, just we enjoyed ourselves.
But the good times would be short-lived. Darkness brought clarity and fear.
I remember it being maybe 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning, and everything was completely black. The winds were raging, the storms coming in.
By the time Deshaun and his family realized they had to find a way out, it was too late.
The water just set. It set and set. It hadn't dawned on us that something terrible had happened and that the levees breached and that the water came rushing in.
Help did eventually arrive. They hitched a ride on a boat making pickups in the neighborhood.
And they were taking kids and women first to the elementary school. We began packing things in garbage bags, whatever we deemed valuable enough to bring with us.
The very same school he was so happy to be away from, now a most welcome sight. For Morris Jeff Elementary School, they were taken to this post office in Mid-City to await a helicopter. Then airlifted to the side of the interstate, where Deshaun and his grandmother boarded a bus for Texas. He ended up finally in Shreveport, the rest of his family in Houston and in Dallas. Deshaun would catch up with them later, bouncing from city to city, and still not done. On to Tampa for a spell. In the midst of all the turmoil, Deshaun stayed focused on the good in his life. He wasn't homeless, he was on a journey, an adventure.
We then boarded a plane, which is the first time I've ever been on a plane. So mind you, throughout this entire process, I've been on a boat, I've been on a, for the first time, which was exciting for me. I was on a helicopter for the first time, and then I got on a plane for the first time. So again, being 14, you know, I was thinking, oh my gosh, we're about to get on a plane now. And I hate to sound like it was a big field trip or a roller coaster ride, but you know, In the midst of everything that was going on, what else was a 14-year-old supposed to look forward to?
And it was the first time he had lived anywhere other than New Orleans.
I actually loved Tampa. I fell in love with it. I was enrolled in school. I was dancing and singing and acting, all that kind of stuff. Like anything, I was able to be a normal 14-year-old by that time.
A month and a half later, his family finally made it back to New Orleans, where Katrina had laid waste to all that they knew. His family moved from place to place within the city, shelters and FEMA trailers, and got to work rebuilding their mid-city home, a home his beloved grandmother would never return to.
My grandma didn't live to see, you know, she didn't even get a chance to go back to that house. My grandma, like, has always been that background up until her dying day, so I will be forever grateful for just even having her around.
And the challenges of post-Katrina New Orleans also became an unfortunate but familiar reality for Deshaun. A childhood friend was gunned down just feet away from his home.
When he was murdered, to me, that was just like a really, it hit close to home. To this day, nothing has come of that situation. He's deceased, and that is it.
Deshaun didn't get mad, he got loud. He spoke out about violence in New Orleans and joined a group called Euthanasia, young people working to end the bloodshed. He helped to organize a march to get the attention of city leaders.
I remember leading and saying, you know, enough is enough. A lot of times when you hear about the reasons that people were killed, it's like that it didn't have to go to that point.
His outspokenness about the city's gunplay got noticed. Director Spike Lee featured Deshaun in a story about post-Katrina New Orleans. It's a dream come true for a kid with his sights set on the bright lights of New York City someday. But the now is right here. Make no mistake, while he doesn't dwell on tough times, Deshaun has been through plenty in the last decade.
I just think throughout the years, there have been a lot of times where I could have been, you know, down and out about stuff, whether it was my roommate bailing on me and I you know, didn't know where I was going to pay rent and thinking I was going to be on the streets or, you know, whether I went through a gambling issue.
But he knows the only sure bet is himself. First Lady Michelle Obama gave him a shout out during her commencement address at Dillard University just last year.
During Katrina, maybe you're like Deshaun Dabney, a graduate who was raised by his grandmother.
Deshaun is one of the first in his family to get a college degree. He's a music lover who strives for a career in the entertainment industry, so he doesn't have time for a woe-is-me outlook on life, even after the trauma of Katrina.
I don't have anything wrong with people expressing what they went through, because that is, you know, that's your story. I just choose to look at it from the opposite side.
It's a glass half full story if there ever was one. Deshaun knows the power of positive thought. While for many, Katrina seemed like the end of the world, for Deshaun, it helps to broaden his horizons.
And then when I just look back and think of where I've come from and all that I've been through, sometimes I'm emotional about it, other times I smile about it. But the thing is, at the end of the day, I'm more so grateful because I could have lost my life in Katrina. I didn't. I'm still here 10 years later. You know, so that simple fact alone is just enough for me to get up and smile every day. And it's just easier to do it. It's easier to smile. My story is still being written. Who knows what the next chapter holds? I think it makes for a greater story to be able to smile through all of that.
Deshaun's story echoes a theme we've seen in so many of our young men and women: persistence, determination, and with each success, inspiration for us all.
Everyone who lived through the storm knows a child of Katrina. And for so many, mission one, 10 years ago, was protecting those young lives, preserving their future, our future.
In the chaos of August 29th and the days that followed, it would be a monumental challenge.
One faced by members of our own news team, even as they covered Katrina and her aftermath. You may have followed one such crisis as it unfolded, a personal one that played out in a very public way.
It involved WDSU news anchor Norman Robinson, now retired, and his granddaughter. We asked Norman to share his experience with us and to show us the path of life for then 8-year-old Jenna.
A child of Katrina, now a young woman, starting this very week a brand new journey.
It was a sanctuary for my family, my wife Monica, my granddaughter Jenna, and for me. It was our home, and we left it here in the Spring Lake subdivision of New Orleans East for the last time on the morning of August 28th, 2005. Just a few hours earlier, I'd walked through the door, the same door I'd entered countless times before, around 4 a.m. after a marathon shift on the anchor desk. With a storm bearing down on our city, I knew it would be my last chance for some rest for a while. I didn't realize it would be my final hours inside our home. It didn't take long. I received a phone call telling me to get on the road, to get to WAPT, our sister station in Jackson, Mississippi, as quickly as possible. We were setting up shop where we could continue broadcasts in the event of the worst. I was frantic, getting my own affairs in order, literally forcing Monica to evacuate, and there was another problem. My granddaughter Jenna wasn't with us. Jenna was spending the weekend with another member of the family.
I was with my grandmother. See, I got the choice to either stay with Granny or Graham, which is Poppy's ex-wife. So I was like, let me evacuate with Graham for once because I've never done that before, and I went to see all my cousins on her side.
10 years ago, communication wasn't so easy. As it turns out, I couldn't reach Jenna or anyone with her. With the monster storm bearing down on us and time running short, I left home with a sense of impending doom. My wife and our pets evacuated to her sister's home in Mobile, Alabama. Jenna was headed for parts unknown with my ex-wife, her grandmother.
I didn't feel like in danger at any point because I was with my grandmother, my family. We were in the house, it was fine.
I was a zombie. A frustrating 9-hour contraflow drive to Jackson, a dead cell phone, and no way to communicate with anyone outside my car. Most of all, I worried about my granddaughter. I had no idea where she would end up. My anxiety grew as the pictures began to roll in, my sanity kept in check only by the long hours spent broadcasting from the anchor desk in Jackson.
Channel 6 is simulcasting with our sister station here in Jackson, Mississippi for
4 days. That's how long I feared the worst. 4 days of constant worrying, no will to eat. I lost almost 20 pounds, reaching out to everyone I could, trying to locate Jenna.
I didn't expect it to be as big as it was. So I was like, okay, this is a vacation. Like, I don't have school. This is great. So I kind of wanted to leave. Like, I probably had one bag with a few clothes. And then I brought my guinea pig and my cat.
Finally, there was something. A call from Monica telling me that Jenna's Graham had evacuated with our granddaughter to her sister's home in Picayune. But my heart sank. The eye of the storm had crossed right through Picayune. My anxiety and fear intensified.
And I was hearing about it from my grandmother, who I guess heard about it on the radio, because there was no way for us to talk to him. So there, we were on the radio, we heard, oh, like Norman Robinson's, his granddaughter's lost.
I would spend countless hours on the phone with the Red Cross trying to track down information about missing persons. I dreaded the possibility that I would find Jenna and her grandmother listed among the casualties. And just as suddenly as my world had been turned upside down, a breakthrough. Word from my ex-wife that she and Jenna were okay.
At that point, I hadn't seen the news or seen like what it's done to the house or whatever, so I thought, oh, we're just gonna go home later.
You can't guess how much of a relief it is for us to be able to finally track the whereabouts of our granddaughter down this morning. All of the emotion that I had been holding inside rushed to the surface. With a sigh of relief, joyous, grateful, yet overcome, the tears flowed. Images of the thousands of helpless men, women, and children trapped by flood and destruction flashing before my eyes. Photojournalist Stefan Cage and I drove hurriedly from Jackson to Picayune, dodging the destruction left by the monster storm, my chest pounding every mile of the way. Who's this little girl?
Hi!
Seeing Jenna for the first time in what seemed like an eternity, all I could do was just grab her and hold on.
You're choking me.
Mm-hmm. We were so worried about you, little girl.
A grown man emotionally spent. As for the child.
I was just worried about my tooth that fell out, and I was like, oh, like, can you give me some money? Like, I probably should have been a little bit more moved, but I was just, I don't know. It was just so normal for me to just see him. I didn't think that I would never see him again, that there was a possibility that I would never see him again.
Jenna returned with us to Jackson, then on to Houston, where she would live with one of my five sisters while I set my full attention to work. As with other children of Katrina, life went on for Jenna, but it was life of a different sort.
I was separated from my mom, my grandparents, and I was in a new state, and I was surrounded by new people. All I remember is going through the motions. Poppy put me on a plane to Houston. I went to their house, I unpacked some bags, got a uniform, and went to school, met some friends, and then that was it. Yeah, life went on.
She would enroll at a school affiliated with her beloved Sacred Heart Academy of New Orleans. A few classmates from back home would join her, and she went on to make new friends. Monica and I would make the long drive to Houston on weekends to see her. Afterwards, it was back to the bleak, gray landscape of post-Katrina New Orleans. The absence of our children, a reminder of our loss as a community. In our case, it took 2 years to regroup as a family, settling into our new home in Algiers Point, and Jenna back at Sacred Heart Academy, where she and her classmates had been together since pre-kindergarten.
So my mom gave me the option to either stay in Houston or move. And I was like, I want to go back. I want to see my friends and my family.
Things gradually returned to some sense of normal. The house in disarray, not because of wind and water, but because of sleepovers and group study sessions.
As far as like when I went to school, my friends were still my friends. Everything was the same. It's just the city was kind of dead, and it was kind of depressing.
Months became years. Katrina became less a daily imposition and more of a memory. Before I knew it, Jenna, her classmates, and friends were graduating from high school. Jenna, a national scholar, highest honors, and president of the senior class. And now, 10 years later, to the week, in fact, we're separated for only the second time. But this time, the occasion more sweet than bitter. Just a few days ago, I had the honor of accompanying my granddaughter to Ithaca, New York, where she is beginning her freshman year at Cornell University.
Taking a road trip to New York, so that should be interesting. I'm excited, I really am.
As I think back on the tragedy 10 years ago, I am reminded of the most important things in life, our humanity, that which binds us together as a community, and the love of our children.
You really have to be grateful for what you have. And you really have to make sure you stop and look around, because our life is so fast-paced now that we don't even think about half the things that we have.
Well, I'm just so glad to see you. I don't want to let you go.
I just realized that I have a family that cares about me a lot, and I should be thankful for that, because not everyone has that. He literally dropped everything to find me.
Finding our loved ones, our city, ourselves. A lesson on this 10th anniversary. A reminder to embrace that which we hold dear. Tonight is for all the children of Katrina, all the children that will follow. I'm Norman Robinson.
This presentation of Chronicle, Children of Katrina, was brought to you with limited commercial interruption by the Salvation Army of Greater New Orleans, the New Orleans Firefighters Association Local 632, and West Jefferson Medical Center.